having fun. Hi, welcome to the drill. Steve Lowery, Tom Hoffarth, our good friend John McKelvey, and look who it is, Petros Papadakis.
Hi.
Just love. Tommy, I think it's fair to say when we first started this just a few months ago, the first person we wanted to get as a guest was
John McKelvey.
Miss Joey Heatherton. But she's not available. But he was number two. And we love Petros. Petros, thank you. We know you're busy. And
no, it's my pleasure. It's great to be here during football season. Anything for you guys. It's great to be here in Carson, California.
Woo-hoo!
Home of the Colts. The Carson Colts. And
the
I don't know if you guys knew this, but when I was a younger person, we talk about it sometimes on the radio show. My father, who owned a restaurant in San Pedro, opened a restaurant here in Carson in a building that the family owned, I think still owns it, called Colt Burger.
Really?
Oh.
As a celebration of the Colts. It had the big, beautiful sign. They spent a bunch of money in a big, beautiful turquoise, you know, or the color of the Carson Colts. And, you know, had all these great football memories on the walls.
Right.
And, you know, was really quality.
Gene Baldungle Hall.
Nobody ever went there.
Could it be that they misunderstood the title of the restaurant? Yes? Colt Burger?
Some say.
Oh,
yes.
I got you.
Some say.
Because you guys used to own a horse.
Well, that was after.
And then he disappeared.
Yeah.
No, he burned to death.
I'm very sorry.
But anyway, that's what I think about. I think about the greatness of the Carson Colts. My friend that I played against, Favai, a great linebacker for the Carson Colts, went on to play at Cal now. His son is playing at Washington State, and I do their game. So
the great Gene Baldungle days.
Yeah. My uncle, Victor Pappas, longtime biology teacher at Carson High School.
Oh.
Right.
Roots are deep.
Nice.
So it's great to be here in Carson. Right off Main Street. And my brother-in-law is the brewer for Phantom Carriage, a fine brewery.
And a sponsor of the show now.
Hey, since we're talking about...
Bring over some beer. You like sours?
I do.
Christmas gets a little rough sometimes for the OP. You know, it's like, try this, it's new, and I'm just like, ah.
Since we're talking about restaurants, I wanted to ask you, has everyone seen the story of the Dine and Dash Dater?
Yeah, I saw that.
Oh, this is an awesome story.
Yeah, no, this guy takes a bunch of girls out to bougie restaurants, tell them to order whatever they want. Has a wonderful meal, and then
he
just,
loads up.
You know,
he leaves.
Doesn't eat too much to where he can't sprint out.
He has to sprint.
Yeah.
Although he does order a lot. Like I saw in Long Beach, he ordered 4 glasses of wine, an app, a Caesar salad, 2 entrees, and dessert.
4 glasses? Just ordered the bottle. That's...
Right. And doesn't then took off.
I guess it doesn't make a difference too, if you're not going
to
pay.
But with your restaurant
experience,
your restaurant experience, has that happened to you? Did you have a
no,
way to, as a
I
way
mean,
to have
we
to chase
were
somebody
a risky
out?
Crew to take on.
Oh,
you
no
know,
kidding.
We were an all-male outfit, and a few of us were linebackers. You know, we were all tacklers.
You put the fear of the
and those that weren't tacklers were holding the firearms. In fact, my my cousin John Christus had a rocket launcher in his station wagon. I swear to God,
that's not some kind of euphemism.
Really help
it?
You in a fist fight? Like, hold on. You know, and you run out to the, you know, load up the rocket launcher, set it up, you know. But
logistics.
He literally, it was the 80s, you know, and he was obsessed with
the Vietnam War. But you had nobody stiff you on a bill?
If it happened, I pity the fool, as they say back in the 80s when the restaurant was thriving.
I thought it might happen because it was a very raucous restaurant.
Oh, yeah, so much going on. Sure it did. You'd have to have my dad on, you know. You'll have a 3-hour podcast.
I probably did that while I was at the restaurant once. I probably ran out.
Well, you were probably just drunk.
No, your Uncle Tommy just made me take my cap off.
When I was a kid, I saw a guy, because my dad was really strict about, you know, making sure you were greeted when you walked in the door. Partially because it was a really bad neighborhood when my mother and father started the restaurant. And I did once see my dad, and, you know, we were humble people, you know. We'd clear tables and, you know, wash dishes and clean the toilets. And, you know, my dad, even though it's his restaurant, you know, his hands were full of plates. And some guy was kind of walking and, you know, please go to the front, wait for me. You know, that's my dad. And the guy said something kind of snarky to my dad, and he handed me the, take these. And I took the plates, and he picked him up and threw him like a javelin. out the door, and the guy, you know how the door opened, knows, and he went into the post,
the street.
You know, the light post, and that, you know, he didn't get to join his party. so, you know, it was that kind of vibe, you know what I mean? So we would not have tolerated that. He wouldn't have made it, you know. You have to be fast. You not only would have to be clever enough to get some girl to dupe her into paying, but you would also have to have, like, kick return speed to get out. because there was only one way out. Yeah, you know, it's not was, like the Cheesecake Factory where you hop a fence and you're gone.
Right.
You got to
run through the kitchen.
If you go through the kitchen, you're going to die.
Right.
And if you go out the front, I mean, you're going through the hot gates of Thermopylae. Right. So, it was not often tried. Yeah. But it's a good question. I never thought of it.
It's weird because this story has resonated. The BBC is covering it. And I think
people
part of it...
People want some fun news.
Right. I think people... No one would go through the hell of online dating, and of course, I've done that, to convince someone to go to dinner with you just to rip them off for a meal. So I think something must have... Maybe a woman did that to him, and now he's blamed the entire female race, and now he's finally going to get back at them.
Well, if a woman did it to him, she probably just left a date. Right. Creep. You know?
Yeah, exactly.
Hey, it sounds like you have some plans.
No, I swear to God, no.
Steve.
The breadsticks are free at the Olive Garden.
Do you know he could get... I was looking. He can get 16 years. Oh, for this.
Well, they always pump that up.
Right.
There's like, you know, he could get 25 years. Oh, he got off with 20 hours of community service. Oh, I see.
But then as we were talking about, people probably confuse you for having ownership in the Petros restaurant in Manhattan Beach.
People think all kinds of weird things about me. You know, when I realized how short people's memories were. Because when you're young, you know, you don't know. You know, you think, you know, your era of playing football was the only era.
Right.
You don't really realize that there's only going to be more football players.
Right,
you know, not less. There'll only be more football players, and there'll be more dead football players.
Right.
So I got more perspective on that when, the first game I ever called was a high school player, Los Alamitos high school kid named Antoine Quezon. And then I did his first game in college at UCLA, and he had, like, a couple picks or something. And then he played for, like, three NFL teams for, like, 11 years, and he's been out of the league for, like, 15 years.
Right.
Like, man, wow. I've been doing this a really long time. you just realize that time kind of goes under you, and you just kind of interpret it differently as you get older, too, because I used to be, like, really involved and think, you know, this guy's the best of this of all time. And it's you know, you realize how subjective and relative everything is and really start to feel useless and futile.
Well, ask him about that.
What's that?
So one of the themes, speaking of feeling futile, one of the themes to our show is we always think that people who are not from L.A. want to define what L.A. sports
is
all about.
Okay.
So that's kind of been Steve's...
It was one of the first reasons we wanted to do the show. We got so tired of, like, a New York Times reporter parachuting in for 3 days and then saying, here's L.A. And for whatever reason, L.A. people don't really push back that much. For example...
No, because we have a soft media. You know, we just want to kiss Laker ass. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, it's the truth. You know, a lot of our media is people, and it's a crossover with what the town is. You know, we are a star effing town. Mm-hmm. You know, we worship stardom and fame. And, you know, it trickles into the way we deal with our sports and the way we communicate with our fans. You know, we are a soft media, just college football wise. You know, they're harder in Seattle. They're harder on that UW coach. They're harder even in San Francisco on Cal and Stanford, much harder on their pro franchises. Mm-hmm. San Diego, I don't know. You know, everybody's just stoned.
Yeah, but Steve gets a little bent and feels like we should take ownership of this. So that's kind of what we're trying to do. But
I mean, I think you're right. But the truth is, you know, so many people interpreting sports from Los Angeles are not from Los Angeles.
That's
not
right.
Just the guy parachuting in for 3 days, but the guy that lives on Manhattan Beach Boulevard. You know, those guys are also in, like, Colin Cowherd. You know, he's a transplant. He talks about living in Manhattan Beach, but he doesn't know where Norwalk is.
Right.
He couldn't tell you, you know, how to pronounce Gardena. He'd say Gardenia.
I said Gardenia for the first year I lived here.
You know, and, you know, La Canada.
La Canada. Right.
You know, and little nuances like that are L.A. sports, you know. This guy played at La Mirada. You know, John Arnett played at Manual Arts High School.
Yeah.
You know, to me, that's the stuff about LA sports. I love doing that kind of stuff on my show. Whether it resonates or not, I don't care.
Right.
You know, we'll have Bruce Dern on, and he'll talk. We'll let him talk for 30 minutes, ramble on about a 4x1 race he saw in the Coliseum in the 40s, because that's LA.
Stuff.
You know, that's LA sports. You know, experience. To me, you know, that's the, and it's the Olympic. You know, it's. It's not, Shaq came and, you know, the Staples Center was alive with corporate sponsorship. And, you know, that's not, to me, that's not L.A. sports. L.A. sports is much more localized.
So when you visit other cities, as you do as a broadcaster, do you have people try to say, oh, in LA they do this way, and then do you even like defend it, or do you just like, let them go on and just,
you
like,
know, I think a lot back? Of people that live here or are from here, and I hate to sound like this, you know, but it's the same way in any other, even like Greece, you know, I realized a long time ago when I was a kid, like, wait a minute, the people in the city are sophisticated,
right?
They're like Europeans or Parisians, or, you know, they didn't come to America. We're peasant animals digging up roots. That's why, my, you know, we are a bunch of, we speak Greek like pigs, you know, we have terrible accents, you know, we're from the village, you know,
right.
any American immigrant, like Italians, Greeks and stuff like that, they came here because they were incredibly poor.
Right.
So, you know, you kind of have that realization about, you know, well, you know, maybe I'm not really like I think I am. And, when it comes to Los Angeles or telling people how things are, people are just enamored with the place.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, we have young guys on our crew. They hook up with like five girls a trip in Lubbock because it says LA on their Tinder. I mean,
right.
It wasn't that easy back when we were young, you know? I mean, come on now. You know, like talk to people, right. Call girls on the phone and be like, is your daughter home?
It's true. You had to chat up the parents.
Yeah. Yeah, oh, yeah. It was a different deal. Yeah. Now you just swoop in like the Midnight Rambler, like Mick Jagger over the wall. You know?
Oh, I know.
I'm just like, where did you go? We were, you know, a bunch of married old guys out, the young guys, all they just, because they're from LA or they live in LA. You know, people are enamored with the place. They don't understand. Like, and when I start talking about Greece, a lot of my perception of the way people see the world is just the way like Greek people see the world, because those are the only people that I really knew who weren't Americans, you know, and they really think it's okay. Cowboys, New York City,
right,
and Hollywood,
right,
and that's it. Cowboys shooting each other,
right.
New York City and Hollywood. Mm-hmm. That is the United States of America.
And no Cleveland?
No, I'm sorry.
No, we are so left out.
No, I mean, unless they saw Major League.
Cleveland not big in Greece.
You know, I mean, but seriously, you kind of have to have that perspective. Now, when I travel, and I mean, this sounds douchey too, and maybe it's not the right word, but I am charmed, or I enjoy America.
Right.
You know, I like seeing people. I like talking to people. I like going to places where people are friendly, because I'm pretty friendly when I'm working. If I'm not working, I'm not so friendly. Oh, yeah. But when I'm traveling and working, you know, I like being around people. And I really enjoy that. So I try to get to know it. Like, we're going to Illinois in 2 weeks. And most people are like, oh, you know, Illinois is terrible. Mm. Lovie Smith can't turn it around. You know, and I'm thinking like, man, I get to go take another picture with the Red Grange statue, you know, and maybe they'll have the Red Grange or Dick Butkus jersey that I can buy, a T-shirt jersey, you know, that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
I like, and maybe I can get to La Bamba where they have the burrito the size of your head. You know, Matt tells me about it. It's a guy with a football uniform on, but the head of a burrito on the sign. That kind of stuff is my, that's what I enjoy. And, you know, and I think that's the, if you really love LA sports, that's the kind of stuff you like about LA sports. Like, you know, find me the building.
Well, that's why I always thought you'd be great on ESPN Game Day. You'd be the guy who could just take people out and introduce the city to them.
Yeah. I mean,
You
know, I like working, whatever, but traveling is tough for me. But those guys travel a lot.
And the funny thing is the Hollywood thing that we get saddled with, people say it in such a way as if we don't work hard here. Nobody works harder, as John can tell you, as people who are in show business. They're getting up at 4 in the morning. They're out on the streets. They're lugging stuff. Yeah, there's 2 or 3 stars, but most of those people are incredibly hardworking. Most people don't even know L.A.'s the number one manufacturing city in America. But
I didn't know it.
See, there you go. L.A.'s a very hardworking
town. Of washing
town.
Machines, apparently.
Well, that's another, yes.
But, you know, about like, you know, fine Hollywood, but just give me Hollywood in the 50s. Show me the hotel Red Sanders died in with a prostitute. You know,
yes.
That happened?
That's LA sports. Yeah, somebody finally wrote about it.
I know. Well, kind of.
We
they kind of wrote about it.
Missed your niche, man.
Yeah.
Well, we set it straight. We got, I was on his show and we set him straight.
We had to.
Yeah.
That was,
tired of the lies. I am. It's been 60 years. Can we just say the guy died in bed with a toot?
I think it's like,
you know,
at this point, it's a badge of honor.
Yeah, I mean, whatever. Yeah. You know?
So not to make this sound like the inside the actor's studio, but we wanted a launching point of some questions to ask you and let you pontificate as much as you want.
Please. Okay.
You don't have to just like give one word answers. But so we made a list and we thought this is how we kind of carry the show from here.
Okay.
If that's
okay.
Good.
So it's like,
although, what's that guy's name? Lipton?
Yes. Yeah,
Lipton.
Yeah. Lipton?
Yeah.
We don't want to be Lipton-esque here.
Yes.
But now I feel
that's
like
that's it to Juilliard?
I, I feel compelled to ask a washing machine question because we know Fletcher, his son, is enamored with washing machines to the extent
appliances in general.
Okay,
but washing machines.
As a 6-year-old, we were told now that he repairs washing machines.
Well, he can give advice. He doesn't get in there, but he can tell you like, there's something wrong with the spin cycle, things like that.
But he knows Maytag is.
He knows the difference between Maytag, Samsung, top loader, front loader, stacked washers. Which ones use energy, which ones are electric, which ones use, coal. I don't know what that is. He watches, YouTube on it all day. And then we go to the, we can't go. We got kicked out of Home Depot. But they let
Did you really?
Yeah, they just told us what we were doing was not cool.
That is against God.
At Lowe's, they're cool. Yeah. Lowe's, they know
Remember
us.
That Lowe's, our sponsor.
They let us do whatever at Lowe's.
Yeah. Especially after dark. Lowe's gets Sky a little Park. Freaky.
Yeah, he goes around all the washers, and they just let him do his thing. But
he knows
Depot,
about recalls.
They're dicks at Home Depot.
Wow.
He can't do that. I was like, what, he can't look at the washing machine?
I remember my daughter when
if
she was
young.
If you're
not buying, get out.
Yeah, basically. That's what
when my daughter was young, if a Chevy commercial came on and Bob Seger was singing Like a Rock, my daughter, when she was 3 years old, would just freeze. Just stop. And you couldn't move her until that song was over. And the kids, there's stuff going
Standing
on there,
Standing arrow straight.
Yeah.
I was going to say, Bob Seger just kind of has that effect on everybody, though, right?
It's true.
I think so.
You'd hope not. But, I love the Bullet Band, Against the Wind.
So from our list of questions, we wanted to ask, of course, the cliche one. What's your favorite curse word, and what do you think it says about you?
I used to have a whole routine about my favorite curse word, but I don't know if that's the case anymore. You're allowed to just swear here?
I guess. He does all the time. We never do.
He's a fucking potty.
There you go.
Hey.
I would say
you're a shitty potty.
I've always liked a good slap dick, just to call somebody a slap dick or a cock slap.
Yeah.
But the F word's pretty powerful.
Sure.
Because you can say it in so many different kind of ways. Mm-hmm. Like an astonishment, like an F, mm-hmm. Or like F, really mad.
Yep.
You could really, it's so versatile.
A Jesuit once told me, fuck is the shortest prayer in the English language. When it's said fuck, it's absolute surrender to your faith.
It might have been your best today.
Yes. That was it. So we want to thank you. No, anyway. The question I was interested that you were asked, Tommy, because you strike me as someone, I really enjoy listening to you, but you also strike me as someone who might be a tad restless. Your soul might be a tad restless. So there's the possibility that you have thought about your life outside of radio and media.
Yeah.
If this was absolutely shut off to you, what other line of work or profession would you like to follow?
Aside from washing machine delivery.
I don't know. Because I've done this, Tom met me when I was transitioning that doesn't sound right. Tom helped me when through. I changed jobs from a college football, professional college football player for USC
I like to think we helped shaped and molded you into a broadcaster.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
He was the go-to guy for questions because no one would talk as much as him and say.
Right. And I didn't really, have aspirations to do this for a living. I didn't know what I wanted to do. And then, it happened really fast to where, I was doing a lot of bigger jobs that people worked really hard to get, and I didn't. I didn't really realize the gravity of that. Still really didn't occur to me for quite some time, not until I got married and had kids. I just figured, I could push through everything around offending people, burning bridges, whatever. I could push through everything with talent, I could push through everything with, fire and brimstone. And I did that for a long time, and now it's, that's not a healthy way to be, obviously. It wasn't, that's how I played football, so I've spent the last few years, and it's been pretty painful, kind of deconstructing that and still finding a way to perform and enjoy doing my job and be better, in a lot of different ways. So, I guess to answer your question, what I always think about romantically, which is not feasible and probably wouldn't work, and it probably wouldn't last 10 days, but I would just go to an island and go away.
Yeah.
I would really love to do that. Of course, it's not possible. I have young children that are in school. My wife probably wouldn't be into it. She doesn't
realize. It's a natural reflex when you say that. I scream my wife.
She realizes that Greek islands are probably not really habitated much during the winter. But, you know, I would really love to see if I could be somebody that could just cut it off. Because whether you're really popular or not so popular, or you have people that listen and it matters to them if you're on the air, and I'd like to think to some degree that I do that, you have a tendency to become really self-important about yourself on the air. You know, you become really self-important about, you know, what if nobody hears my opinion today?
Right.
You know, and that's not a good look for a human being, I think. And God, I struggle with it, you know. And, you know, in this kind of work, you struggle with ego. You struggle with, you know, comparing yourself to others, you know, even people really close to you. So I would really love to reach a point in my life someday where I could just literally cut the cord and no longer be relevant in media, if I am at all, like, you know, just be done with it.
Right.
And I don't know financially if I could ever do that, or, you know, I don't know if that day will ever come, but that is my dream. And what I really like doing is reading and collecting music, and really those two things, and being with my family. I'm not really a complicated person.
Tom knows, I've mentioned this to him, that one of my great fantasies,
I like action
films. Yeah, is just to go to Europe and not tell anybody and just be by myself. And when I say that to other people, there's this note of recognition where people go, yeah, I think that is not unusual.
Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't want to be with my wife and children.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. Mine are grown now.
I mean, it's just a stupid pipe dream, and I'd probably go and be like, oh my God, they're averaging 3 yards a carry, son of a bitch, you know, give me on the radio, give me an ISDN line, you know, what are they doing? They're in a shotgun inside the five, son of a bitch, stop it, you know, I mean, that's probably what would happen. I'd probably flip a Yiddo, and, you know.
But my wife, Rhonda, always thought you would be a great English college teacher.
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
With the patches on the elbow and all that.
I would. I did love that part of college. And I think it's not an experience that most guys or most athletes have, probably.
Yeah, the Robin Williams poetry teacher.
Yeah, you know, I had a lot of those at USC. And, you know, whatever you want to think about USC, they had a cool English department. Everybody, you know, big schools like that have cool English departments, and they have cool teachers. And, you know, people that are just, I mean, when somebody's passionate to talk to young people about the past and about literature and about, you know, some like John Keats or something like that. Yeah. And if you can translate that, I mean, that is so valuable to me. You know what I mean? I mean, I know it doesn't really mean much to most people. I asked my TV partner, DeMarco Murray, if I could buy him a book. I was going to buy him Letters to a Young Poet by Rilke. And, he just looked at me like like, you know what? I'm probably just not going to go down that road. But to me, like, that's really powerful. Yeah. And I'm certainly, you know, I could do that. I wouldn't want to have to write a paper to become a professor.
No. I know.
I wouldn't want to have to do any work. You know, I didn't have to apply to college.
Is any work required?
No, I wouldn't have
to. Could you get an honorary degree?
Let me show up. You know, and I could, you know, because I could teach passionately about
that. You could.
Yeah, a few different authors. I enjoy that kind of stuff.
Which authors?
You know, I change all the time, you know. I've become a real Anglophile. I read, like, things like British detective stuff now. British detective stuff written by a woman in Connecticut. Recently, Grimes. She writes a Richard Jury detective. He's like, you know, all proper Margaret Thatcher era England, Scotland Yard. Before that, I read all the Conan Doyle again. Before that, I read all the Raymond Chandler and a guy named Ross McDonald, who's a Long Beach detective. Mm-hmm. He wrote a guy named Lou Archer, Paul Newman character, in one of the and so I got into a lot of noir. The Third Man, stuff like that. But my favorite author when I was growing up and the stuff that used to inspire me was like Robertson Davies. Was a Canadian writer. Right. He kind of taught John Irving to write. You know, I read A Prayer for Owen Meany and I really loved it.
Yeah.
So I wanted to find out the root of it. I kind of do that with music and, you know, and football. You know, if I like, you know, if I like a certain kind of football or like the Wildcat, it's like you go back and, okay, well, that's the wing tee. It's a single wing, mm-hmm. you know, so I like to do that kind of stuff. So I went back and found out that John Irving, you know, was taught to write by this guy, Robertson Davies. Oh. Or like if you really like Charles okay. Bukowski, who's a local writer, mm-hmm. died in San Pedro.
Yeah.
The guy that taught him to write was another local writer from Colorado, but transplanted, and a Latino guy named, or maybe he was Italian. Named John Fanta. Fanta. Yeah, Fan, yeah. F-A-N-T-E.
Yeah.
Ask the Dust. Mm-hmm. You know, so that's kind of, you know, the stuff I enjoy doing. And I'm by no means an expert in any of it. I'm just a fan of...
But that's the beauty of your show with Matt for this long. How long has it been, 15 years?
This is our 12th or 13th year.
Mm. Yeah, but the beauty of it is your show, as people know, is probably 20% sports mm-hmm. and the rest is...
Yeah, and Matt always puts it like this, and more, you know, I actually, you know, sort of halfway hear what he's saying. He puts it like...
any good relationship.
Yeah.
Yeah.
what was that? Sometimes it sounds like the Peanuts guy. You know, he says, like, you know, we're lucky because by the time we get on the air, everybody's done talking about everything.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
You know, and I never really thought of it like that because I'd do it either way.
Right.
But it's true. And if we do too much sport, people get mad now, you know, they're kind of conditioned to, and it's not like, you know, I use sports as a foundation, but the radio, you know, it's really interesting. I had a really interesting experience today, and I hope it doesn't sound self-serving because I'm not trying to be that way, but, you know, people come up to me, not in droves, but when you do radio, sure. you know, you connect with people in a different
kind of way.
Right,
it's very intimate.
And, you know, I did a yoga class this morning, like I do every morning, and a beautiful woman, you know, was older than me, came up to me and introduced herself, and she's married, actually, for 3 weeks to a guy I know, an older Greek guy, and but she knew the show from way before that, and mm-hmm. she said, I was a caregiver, and I had a dying man, this man named Brian, and he was riddled with cancer, and I was with him for years, and the most important thing was the Petros and Money show.
Oh.
And I'd put it in his ears, mm-hmm. and, you know, I'd listen along with him, and I became a fan of the show, you know. And that's you guys, cool. you know, when you're in a room right. doing a show, you don't think of... And then I went and got my hair cut for the podcast, and... you know, not to be too sappy, you know, so then I went to get a haircut for the podcast, and I'm sitting there getting my haircut, chopping it up at the barbershop, not like LeBron's barbershop, no goblets of wine and John Stewart, but a barbershop nonetheless, and in Redondo, and
I need to go to one.
Yeah, no, you look good.
No, I mean, which barbershop?
The one with the guy with the face tattoo.
Is it on
not the one
PCH?
Deep in the Riviera, the one right off the thing? I don't know. The one that looks at the back of... the Rock and Bruise.
Oh, okay.
That one.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
South Bay Barbershop or something.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. I've been to that guy. Yeah, I've been to that guy.
Face tattoo.
Yeah, it's the same
upside down pyramid.
With the red building.
On the face.
The red building with the... Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
Mm-hmm. Face. But anyway, yeah, no, and a guy came up to me at the barbershop after I got my hair cut, and he was like, you know, your show helped me talk to girls.
Wow.
And I was like, you know, and this is like a young guy with a tattoo sleeve,
right.
real good looking, and, you know, 30-year-old guy or something. And he was like, I was like, what do you mean? He's like, you know, the way you say tonight.
Oh.
And I was like, you mean the way Ron O'Neill says tonight in Superfly? I mean, because that's, you know, because that ain't me, dude. That's Ron O'Neill in Superfly. You know, that's just how we heard tonight, because I would
but
watch.
That's exactly why I think listening to your show works, because when you get into Lance Romance, you're not giving away crappy advice.
Well,
this is great.
I haven't
stuff.
Done it in like 6 months.
I know, but it doesn't. It, whenever you do it, or when Matt does,
yeah,
his gambling advice.
Right. Yes,
yeah.
Yes,
I mean, it's legitimate stuff. It's not bad advice. It really works.
Well, I've been to a lot of therapy, you know, I just found it was interesting. You know, that you have an old man. You know. And he's probably listening for a completely different reason, you know, and both people are, their lives are affected. And it's, you know, it's just an AM radio show. You know, it's not, you know, and, you know, I resist talking about things that are really important to people to a certain degree. Yet, but because in that, I think the show is important to people to, you know, just to kind of get through the day. And more as I'm getting older, I appreciate that part of it, too. Because when I was younger, I really liked talk radio. It's kind of hard for me to be into now because that's what I do. For every once in a while, I listen to Tim Conway Jr. and I'm just like, this guy's a genius.
Yeah.
You know, this guy's so freaking good, mm-hmm. you know. But that doesn't happen very often. I don't listen too much to much else.
Tommy, you're the media critic, so tell me if I'm right here. Their show has got to be one of the like key shows in kind of changing what sports talk is, right?
Well, it's a natural chemistry that happens.
Yeah.
And some people are good at just talking sports, and some are good at not talking sports. And I think when you have that crossover, it resonates with a lot of people who are more like us that have other interests and want to be more well-rounded and learn about whose birthday it is. And things like
I just couldn't do it.
Yeah.
You know, I just couldn't do it. I just couldn't sit down and be like, I mean, I heard the other day they were going through the NBA's top 100 players. It's just like, fuck. Yeah, I mean, you know, or like, you know, hey, who's the best power forward in the West?
Right.
You know, who do you think it is? And it's just like, I don't know, man.
No, that's not even a discussion.
I was on a Catalina boat the other day, and this guy worked for the NFL Network. He's like, right now, $5,000. Who's going to win the Super Bowl? I was like, just throw your money off the freaking boat. Dude. Just shut up. You know, I'm hungover, coming back from Catalina.
I've been looking at washing machines all day.
I'm on a boat. Yeah. We did. We had a good washing machine at the rental.
There you go.
Fletcher was very pleased with the wash.
Go Fletch.
Very slow.
I love Fletcher.
He was not happy about the speed of the spin cycle.
Does he like hand washing? Hand washing.
Well, no, yeah. You know what he does?
Yeah.
He bought a salad spinner.
Oh.
And he puts soap in it, and he's turned to and clothes, and he literally washes clothes, and he does a slow cycle. Then he cranks it. Then
that's
he does
awesome.
The rinse. So
oh
he literally
Lord.
Turned a salad spinner into a functional washing machine and did his own wash.
God.
What
this
a genius.
Kid is awesome. I was going to ask, was it a...
Do you ever see the movie Rushmore?
Yes.
Where Bill Murray goes, never in my life did I think I would have sons like these. They lock the door on him. He's like, unlock it! That's what he did. He does that all. He locks the door on me. He's like, grabs his crotch. I'm like, what is... And it's
that's
like,
awesome.
I grew up in such a violent house where they hit us all the time.
Yeah,
and I've never hit him, but I've never wanted to more, you know. And it's like, I just like, you
know.
And it's like, he's violent toward me. And it's like, wait a minute. I don't hit any. Why are you violent toward me? What happened?
I
Is it just bread in the bone?
I run into him at a Fat Burger, and the first thing he goes, don't let him hit you.
Really?
Oh, he punched Tom right in the face.
Damn. Tom has a face like that.
Yeah, he did. You're sockable.
Yeah.
There's no doubt.
I was going to ask, when you and Matt got together, was this a conscious decision where you said, hey, let's try to do something different?
No,
or was this a natural kind of
You know,
thing?
I mean, I think Matt was still figuring out what he wanted to do in sports talk radio, like daily sports talk radio. He had done sports for K-Rock, and he worked on a morning show, which was, you know, much more inclusive with all the other stuff. And that fact they had to be really light sports.
Yeah.
And Matt's much more intense with sports and, you know, watching everything and keeping up with the stats, you know, much more than I am. You know, he's got more jobs at this point than I do. So I think Matt knew that I would be good with him.
Yeah.
You know, and we talked a lot. And Don had tried to hire me before for something else. And then Fox Sports Radio, the national one, tried to hire me before for something else. But I wanted to be on in the afternoon in L.A.
Yeah.
So, you know, that worked. And Matt and I came together. We had a relationship and we knew each other from before. And, you know, it took a while to figure it out.
Mm-hmm.
It's still, we're still figuring it out in a lot of ways. And a lot has changed about the show since it started. But the template of it is not very different from what I was doing, you know, on the, you know, the Dead and Alive Guy Burke the other day, Lance Romance, you know, the Fight Club, you know, was something we were doing right away.
Mm-hmm.
Matt figured out the film Fight, you know, so we could do two movies because I used to just review one movie, you know. And it's like, Matt's competitive. And I was like, you know, I don't want to fight, you know. You know, I was like, can't we just play the clips? You know, and we've added a lot of things, you know, over the year. But that template of just, you know, doing a whole segment that's planned that has nothing to do with sports, where you're going to play clips from the Ten Commandments. You know, I was doing that on 1540.
Right.
The bravery was Don Martin and Matt, you know, who'd already been working a year together at 570, being open to me coming in and doing that then.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think it was a shock to him and everybody involved. But and, you know, it certainly freaked out all the older guys. You know, I did a lot of that when I first started working. And now I realize just how goddamn annoying I must have been to everybody when I first came into to the business around 2001. But
when you were talking about maybe going to an island being by yourself, your persona, whether on TV or radio, very accessible, very friendly, which means when you're out, I'm sure people think,
oh, sure.
He'll want me to come up.
Yeah.
How do you deal with that?
Everyone thinks they know you. I'm grateful to see everybody.
Yeah, he is.
My wife is not. Sometimes my wife gets a little, I remember one night at the Admiral Risty.
Oh, yeah.
Well, you know, she got a little frustrated.
I don't blame her.
Because, you know, well, you know, if I'm not there a lot, you know, and I've been traveling a bunch, you know, she gets it.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, I'm not famous. I'm public. That's what I tell people. You know what I mean? I'm not really a politician either. But,
right.
You know, and sometimes, you know, you'll hit a vein of people and they know you.
You know,
like I was in Catalina the other day and I realized, like, you know, after like an hour or two, I realized, like, oh my God, you know, everybody on this island is just, you know, these are my people. You know, people are from Santa Clarita, San Pedro, Glendale, Gardena. You know, they all been to the restaurant. They all have a connect. They all know a high school kid. And I mentioned his name on the challenge. Some of them are college football fans.
Right.
But, you know, I'll go to a place like that that's distinctly local.
Yep.
You know, because Catalina is not a place where people that aren't local travel to. You know, they wouldn't even figure out to. It's only people whose families are from Los Angeles. Those are my listeners.
Yep.
And really big fans of Step Brothers.
Ah, there you
go. That movie? See,
Catalina Wine
Mixer. That's how OG I am. I have no idea what that is. That's where Natalie Wood died, all
right? Yeah, right. Yeah.
Two harbors, man.
Yeah. Too soon.
But, you know, and I realized, like, wow, this is going to be, you know, and... You know, instead of being a little bitch about it, you know, I just embrace it. You know what I mean? I was at a bar, like, holding onto the back of an old man's head, like, you know, 6 hours later, like, ah, I love you, Jim. You know, let's go Pacoima. You know, I mean, and if I'm out and that's, you know, I mean, you know, I'm a sucker for people. Mm-hmm. You know, I grew up in a restaurant, you know, trying desperately to make people happy.
Well, right. And it was great for tips, I'm sure.
Yeah. I mean, we have no dignity.
Yeah.
So I'd like to think I have dignity.
Right.
But all somebody has to do is, like, you know, just wink at me. And I'm just like, you know, whatever you want. Well, yeah. I'll give them my hat. You know, and it's a funny thing, too, like doing college football. It's like, you know, you'll be going to meet a coach and be like, man, this guy sucks. You know, this program sucks. Yeah. I hate this guy's offense.
Yeah.
How much are you like your dad then?
Well, in a weird way.
Yeah.
But, like, you go to the football thing, like, with that attitude. And this happens to media people all the time.
Yeah.
You know, and my dad was like this, too, because if somebody would come, you know, that guy sucks. He came into the restaurant. Oh, I love you. Yeah. Oh, hello. You know, but, you know, it'll happen all the time. Like, the coach would be like, you know, hey, Petros, how's your daddy or something like that? You're like, oh, coach. You know, then you're on the air going, oh, you know what? They might have lost by 40, but give Coach a break.
Yeah, right.
You know, come on, guy, give Coach a break. He knows what he's doing. He's rebuilding this program.
Right.
They know what they're doing. You know what I mean? And I am just as gullible as a 20-year-old kid who's doing it his first time.
They're all hanging on to jobs, man.
Right?
Yeah, we all are.
Well, Tom and I have talked about this a number of times when we were daily sports writers. What players and coaches didn't understand, all they had to do was make that little bit of effort. And, like, if I was writing something critical, I loved it when the person I was writing about wouldn't call me back. Great. I just can say whatever I want. But if I talked to him, I'd go like, he's a good guy.
Yeah, I don't want to do it to him.
Yeah. So just all you have to do is say, how you doing? Yeah. Oh, thank
you. There's a human element that maybe people understand a little bit more now because the lines between what a real journalist is, and I'm not a journalist.
No, it's hard.
You know, the line is so blurry. Yeah. And it sucks now, you know, because really the people that cover these teams are fans, and they don't do the job.
Right.
You know, and I've never done the job. You know, I'm not a beat writer or a columnist or anything like that. You know, I have my own unique place. But, you know, when I grew up, the writers did a job.
Yes.
You know, they followed us and they did a job. They were literary people. They knew how to write.
Mm-hmm.
And they held people accountable. You know, they did the Orwellian thing. You know, they printed what people did not want told. That was their job.
Right.
Now, they kissed our ass a little bit. They were sports fans, and they liked being, you know, it's fun to be around a football team.
Right.
You know what I mean? But they did the freaking job.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't see that. I mean, I just see people that are fans that just give the message of the PR department.
Right.
They just, like a penguin, you know, throwing up in its baby's mouth.
Yeah.
They just throw up in the mouth of the fan. And you have fans listening.
Right.
And you have, I mean.
But you and I have talked about this. It's completely correct. When we were working, you could get fired for that. If you told someone who your team was, if you were a fan of a team, they would fire you. Now
it's maddening. And it's just like
sports writers will say we and us.
Yeah, and they're just not they're not journalists.
Right.
And it's like, so you're not a journalist, you're like a blogger or like a fan site.
I don't know
or
what they are.
You know, mm-hmm. who credentialed you?
Where
you
they're,
suck.
They're an aggregator is basically what they
are. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Aggregated is a good word to put, you know. That's a big word that I resisted for a long time. Yes. But that really is what they do. So, you know, we still have journalists,
right.
you know, but in this town especially, it's like, no, we have somebody that carries a tripod around and does like web hits. It's not,
yeah.
you know, it's not the same.
You in fact have been accused of the thing that you were supposed to do when you were a sports writer, which is from USC. You seem to give pretty good scrutiny to your former school.
Yeah.
And in no way, whatever, if no one knew who you were, no one would ever guess that you had played football at USC ever.
No. I've you know, and I'm not, you know. Super proud of everything I've done in that situation, but I stand by pretty mm-hmm. much 90% of it. You know, I've been petty and stupid over the years, and I grew up covering USC. The reason my career took the arc that it did, good or bad, is because USC became really, really good right when I got into the media. Right. There was nobody out there to interpret their message.
A sideline reporter on the radio, and then
right to the national TV with Barry mm-hmm. on cable, but not network, but the Fox network. There was nobody really cared about the West Coast.
Yeah.
So, you know, I was there to interpret the message.
Right.
So it was really good timing, for me. So, you know, it's an interesting relationship, mm-hmm. you know, but I was never going to just, I resented when somebody said, well, you have to do this because you played there. Well,
yeah.
You have to, this has to be your message.
Yep.
And, I wouldn't, you know, that's not me. That's right. Never, you know, so, I mean, I just, you know, I immediately resist that,
right.
you know,
yeah.
or find a way subtly to resist
right.
it.
And, yeah.
And I had the opportunity, when, after a couple of years, I got offered a bigger job with Fox that we talked about. And, SC offered me a job saying, you know, we could do a 3-man booth, and Pete would, no, we can't. and I kind of had to, like, you know, should I do,
that's
you
right.
know, should I wear a cardinal jacket my whole life
right.
and shake hands and
right.
fight on and, you know, get fired when Pete gets fired? Or, you know, I want to see what the football office looks like in Pullman.
Right.
You know, and that was a, you know, it was tearing a scab off. I decided to do the other, the national thing, which was
yeah.
a better decision for me.
Yeah.
And I did that for 9 years. And then I had to rip the scab off again and start doing Big 12 games, you know, and mm-hmm. get comfortable in a new place with people that, you know, they don't even know me as a football player. They just think I'm an ugly guy that does games. And now I'm doing Big 10 games the last
yeah.
couple of years, you know. So there's always, and I'm 41, you know, so there's always new horizons, new experiences
right.
to have. And, you know, I enjoy that part of it. But when it comes to my alma mater, I've always been hypercritical,
mm-hmm.
Probably a little too much. But at the same time, you know, what's happened at my alma mater in the last 15 years has been unprecedentedly disastrous.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we've had two guys who I know well and saw coming personally implode on the job, and then another guy to use chaos as a ladder and is now the head coach. And which is, you know, he's a good guy. And
right.
We all agree on that. But, and then, you know, the problems at the university had
yes.
beyond the athletic department were, that's my era too.
Right.
Know, that's my wife, my sister, Trojans, you know, they're people that use the medical facilities there. They've done a lot of fundraising at my dad's restaurant. You know,
yeah.
I know a lot of the people involved, Max Nikias, and a lot of it really just turned me off.
Mm-hmm.
I was really proud of the reporters for the Times, especially the two that went to USC
yes.
With that story. So, you know, and I did the PA there, and, you know, I
mm-hmm.
wasn't super dedicated to it 1 year because I was doing other work, and I kind of wanted to come back to it, and they didn't, I mean, they have every right to fire somebody,
right.
but they kind of texted me and didn't even tell me I had to ask. So you know, I got kind of butthurt about
right.
it. But I'm currently trying to climb the ladder of repair. You know, I don't have much hope for them on the field. But I think, you know, I think they're headed in a better direction.
Let me ask an actual sports question. The Pac-12 now seems to inhabit this nether region between the four power conferences themselves mm-hmm. and then
well,
the mid-majors.
That's not true.
Well, they seem to be in a bit of a lull.
Well, they had a rough couple years. But
is this temporary or is this?
Nah, well, you know, you have there has to be teams that can physically push Auburn or Georgia or Ohio State off the ball.
Yeah.
USC is not a physical football team. They're not coached that way. They don't have those players.
Right.
That train has left the station. You know, that balloon has popped. So, you know, like what Bill Plaschke was saying the other day, like, student body right. It's like, well, you know, even if you put him in that formation, you know, it's like, you know, it's like putting a bunch of cats in that formation and going like, you know, they ain't going to do shit.
God, I can't get that image, gentlemen.
To me, you know, I mean, if they're going to be good, they have to do what they do. But, you know, to be able to physically push those elites off the ball, you have to be elite physically and have the mentality. They had that under Pete Carroll. But who can be elite physically on the West Coast? Who has the players? There's only three teams currently. Washington, who can do it? Defensively, they did it in a playoff game, and they were just in the playoffs. You know, they didn't play well offensively in that game because Jake Browning's probably not that dynamic of a guy. But Washington is there physically and on defense. They're there. Stanford is there in a way. They, you know, their depth is an issue, but I mean, they're pretty versatile. They can push those teams off the ball in a football game.
Right.
Believe it or not, Utah can. We've seen it done. You know, we saw it done, but USC in their current form cannot, you know. And to me, that's what you see. That's why, you know, well, Clay Helton won 10 games 2 years in a row. It's like, okay, yeah, but when you played against Ohio State, they didn't move one inch. You know, when you played against Alabama, they didn't move one inch. It was embarrassing. That's why Michigan had to hire Harbaugh. They'll let him win six games a year there in a way that they would never let a guy like Rich Rod, because that's the football they're used to.
Yep.
They want to see them grind it out. That's their mentality. And it's weird to me that USC's sitting here in a spread and nobody goes, hey, wait. You know, now they're just starting to. And I've been saying it, you know, for 3 years. It's very odd.
Right.
So basically they're taking themselves out of the conversation. You know, I mean, because if they can't physically dominate at the line of scrimmage when they need to, they can't compete in the playoffs.
But could it be that the Pac-12 is the first conference that is feeling the effects of parents saying, I don't want my kids playing football?
No. Yeah. The West Coast still, I mean, you're right. There's a lot of that, but it's, I don't think it has anything to do with the Pac-12. I think if you look at the SEC, a lot of what you think about it is skewed by the national television contract that they have. They have power teams and they have have-nots, just like we have.
Sure. Right.
If you look at the Big Ten, it's exactly the same way. Right. 107,000 people at Michigan, 35,000 in West Lafayette, you know, down the road. So, you know, it's not really that different. The ACC has freaking Wake Forest in it.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I just think because we're close to it here and they made a mistake with the Pac-12 network. They made a distinct mistake, and they've suffered for it. Now, on the field, they've had a rough couple of years, but is every football innovation coming from the Pac-12? Is the best rookie in the NFL from the Pac-12? The answer is yes.
Yeah.
You know, the West Coast is the innovative place for football in this country. It ain't Tuscaloosa. It's not Auburn, Alabama. It's not Ohio State. You know, they play football in a different way.
Mm-hmm.
It's certainly not Notre Dame, I could tell you that much.
You know, it's interesting. When he changed the grass and they let him change the grass, you know.
That was huge.
That's a big deal. And that kind of freaked me out.
Mm. And they got training tables and shit, too.
Yeah.
Never happened.
But, you know, I understand to a certain, you know, the kicking and screaming and resisting change and being dragged into the 21st century, you know, is not fun for a lot of us. And some stuff should never change, but I think some stuff should. You know, people did get hurt on that grass a lot, you know, there's no doubt. This guy plays a faster brand of football. You know, it bothers me because I played on that grass and I want to see USC Notre Dame on that grass slogging it out in late October. That's what I want to see.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's okay to accept some. Like when they first started doing the hitting, you know what I mean? When they first started changing the way guys hit and calling stuff, I mean, I was just appalled. You know, I'd be doing the games and I'd be in the talk back. We just can't even play anymore. This is ridiculous. You know, I mean, you're just really emotional about it. And, you know, over the years, I've started to see, hey, you know what? The kids are doing pretty good. You know, the game is exciting, and they're not out there, like, literally trying to murder each other like we were. We wanted to murder each other. We wanted to. And And, you know, so, you know, you see things change for the positive, and it makes you feel a little bit better.
Well, explain
about
the injuries that you've been through, and to piggyback on that, too.
What time is it?
I know. We have
It's
what's it? Oh, you're good. I can
good?
Do the injuries.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Just one of the coolest things I ever saw was last
we got plenty of time.
April when he and Matt were out at the golf tournament. Tiger mm-hmm. Woods, they got a nice exclusive with Tiger. So after the interview was over, he and Tiger
it was leveraged to the hilt.
He and Tiger, are comparing
leveraged
injuries.
Leveraged up the ass.
And Tiger says, you're talking about your injuries.
Oh, he wanted to talk about
asked, did you guys get shot up?
Yeah, yeah. He wanted to talk about USC injury culture.
Right.
Which is a relatively famous in the world of football behind the scenes.
Right.
And we had a very interesting conversation.
It was.
You know,
it was fun to watch.
I went through, I mean, I always say that I'm not unique. You know, everybody gets hurt, this and that. But the truth is, you know, the injury I had was especially horrible. I shattered my right foot in 1999. I've had, I don't know, 8 or 9 surgeries on it. The original injury was a very bad injury. You know, it just cleared out the joint. Everything was gone except for this bone here. Like, everything was gone, mm-hmm. like a bag of cereal. Yeah. And in repairing it, which was a long reparation, of course, I got a staph infection. Mm-hmm. But the staph infection was in the bone,
right,
which is osteomyelitis, which means, you know, you have a good chance of losing your leg. So I fought through that for about 6 months, you know, from running a really good 40 and thinking you're going to have to, you know, play in the NFL and run down on somebody's kickoff team to living in a hospital bed. It really did kind of humble me a lot as a person, you know. I've been varying degrees of an asshole in my life, but this was kind of like,
well, do you think you have CTE, or do you worry about that stuff?
You know, you don't know until you die, but
right.
Certainly I feel that kind of stuff, you
really?
Know, but you know, the foot thing I did work through, you know, and, you know, I had a pick line and, you know, a wheelchair and slowly started running. I scored 8 touchdowns on the one little leg. You know, I went back and played one more year. Mm. Obviously, you know, that wasn't a dream of mine, but whatever.
Well, it wasn't a great team either.
But. Yeah, but whatever I was going to do in the NFL was going to be over. You know, I couldn't pass the physical, which was fine with me. I didn't want to play anymore, and my foot still really, really hurts. But that was, you know, kind of the story. As far as the other stuff, which is actually much more disturbing, you know, I was a violent football player.
Right.
And, you know, I had to play that way. I had to hit everybody with my head and face. Otherwise, I would not. If I wasn't violent enough, I wasn't going to be good enough. Because I didn't, you know, I wasn't cat-like.
Right.
I was very fast, but I was very fast right to your Adam's apple.
Right.
You know, and I had to be violent to get to get up toward the top of the depth chart at SC in the first place. You know, I really paid my dues in practice more than I did in the game. You know, back then you could destroy yourself in USC practices. And if you don't believe me, ask Charles White, ask anybody. Yeah, those were wars before they changed the rules. Now I sound like a really old man. But, you know, as far, like, I just remember getting hit and, you know, not often, but not infrequently either. You know, it just, your face is like a TV and everything just turns off. And then it comes back on and you're somewhere else.
Right.
Happened to me in a football game once against Oregon State, and it was really visible on TV. And it's kind of funny if you're not me. Mm-hmm. And I remember I was doing an event for Mike Riley, and they played it like for like 2,000 beeves, and everybody's laughing.
Right.
And I don't know what happened to me, because usually, you know me, I don't care if people say anything about me, but I was like, it freaked. I had a moment of like this really horribly frightened moment, and it kind of shocked me. Like, I don't watch myself play football. I don't watch
no, but
tape.
That has got to be.
It freaked me out.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? And, you know, I go to a lot of therapy, do stuff like that, but I think just like for anybody, it's just, you know, you have to learn whatever to stay 2 yards away from what your emotions are, maybe sometimes 5, you know, and whatever your emotions are, just to try to, you know, because doing what I do for work too, it's like that's when I get most emotional, because I got to kind of strip raw to do the radio show and perform.
Right.
And I find myself getting, you know, hurt easily and more offended when I'm doing that than in my normal life. I'm kind of better at dealing with it.
Mm. Well, that kind of rolls into the last thing I wanted to ask you about was I get up early in the morning to move my car. So I hear you go on with
Clay, yeah.
Clay Travis. Clay Travis is probably one of the most polarizing sports talk show hosts around. And you've known him for a long time. We were talking about this earlier about who do you compare him to? And, you know, very conservative.
Wally George.
Right.
He's calm. Right. You know.
But when I think
Wally wasn't calm.
When I think about why you would go on with him, I would think right away, why would you do that? But then when you have a conversation with somebody who's even at opposite, if it's the art of conversation, it's the art of knowledge, it's the art of learning something new. I always learn something new when I listen to you two guys talk.
Yeah.
Is that one of the reasons why you like to go on there? Or
I like Clay. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, I knew him before.
Right.
I mean, when I met Clay, he used to yell and scream and defend Obama to people.
Really?
You know, I mean, which I don't care about either. Yeah. You know, I mean, I'm not very political, and I don't really think anybody would ever want to tune in to hear my opinion. Now, for a guy like Clay, it's different. He's got a law degree, and he's got a different kind of audience. And I get it. You know, I get it. I don't begrudge anybody their style. You know, I certainly do things differently. You know, I've done sports talk radio differently for a long time.
Yeah.
You know, I did a lot of stuff on sports talk radio before a lot of people were doing, Matt and I were doing, you know, Bachelorette reports.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You know, long before people did stuff like that
right.
in sports or just general radio.
Right.
I don't begrudge him his style or anything like that. Not everything he does I agree with. Not everything he does I disagree with. I don't have a problem having a conversation with somebody. I think the problem we have these days is we're just overly, and it's rich me saying this, but we're just overly ruled by emotion. You know, people that are just completely and totally emotional, mm-hmm. Who don't want to have a conversation logically on one side or the other, make it impossible for the rest of us.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, and they really do. And you've got to say, you know, one way or the other, you know, like there's a gun to your head, like you're in a voter's booth.
Yeah.
And it's like, you know, that's not the world. I think we all know that, you know, we all had crossover overlaps in relationships with significant others. You know, the world is gray,
we change our opinions.
Well, look, it's the Serena Williams thing. You know, it's like, you can say Serena Williams is the greatest female athlete. She's an inspiration. She's a marvel. And she was wrong. Those two things can be
exactly
right. Yeah. They can both be right.
Yeah.
Right.
You know, and you're not a racist if you say that, and you're not and on the other side you're not some kind of, you know,
some sycophant.
Yeah, weirdo freak mm-hmm. who loves her and you know, but that's what offends me about our work. It's like, you know, she's 100% wrong.
Yeah.
But there's people saying, oh, no, this reflects our society. It's like, no, don't use it to paint your own BS.
Mm. Well, the part that C was talking about, and we had a discussion about this, the laziest part is when people say it's PC, right? Or what?
Oh, yeah, kinds of things. Where?
Oh, it's just the easiest place to go. And it's such
You were offended.
Sorry you were offended by that.
Yeah. And it's such a fast place for all of us to go. We're so quick to point a finger and like, oh, no, that guy's a racist. Or, oh, no, that guy doesn't.
You don't get what I'm
saying.
That
guy's a fascist or that guy's a socialist. And it's like, I mean, what happened? Well, we started labeling each other when everything got, you know, deduced to however many characters. You have on Twitter.
We would put it on them for not understanding us.
Yeah.
Like, come on.
Yeah, and you know, it's okay to be a little bit questioning of everything coming at you these days. And I feel like, you know, in a lot of our world, like if you question anything, you can be labeled right away.
Right.
Yeah.
And it can really hurt you.
Right.
And it's a very weird, interesting time to do this kind of work.
Well, in your line of work, are you under any kind of pressure to always have an opinion about something? Can you
I refuse to.
Yeah.
Like, you know, I mean, like the anthem thing. It's like, you know, it's too nuanced.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, people don't understand the military is an advertiser with the NFL.
Mm-hmm.
You know, one thing we don't want to do, I mean, I say a lot of stuff on the air. One thing I don't do is piss off advertisers.
Right.
And that's a big-time advertiser. And obviously it skews things. Because now, you know, they started doing the anthem with the players out there on TV because the military's advertising. Because the military has recruitment stations set up, NCAA and NFL. Okay, well, I respect the military. I don't think this is a bad country. But I also respect the guys that don't think they're getting a fair shake by the cops. You know, I'm not a black guy.
Right.
I played football at USC. I'm captain of the football team. I know a lot of black guys.
Yeah.
I know that they're not making that up.
Right.
You know, so, I mean, but I'm not going to sit here and say, you know, Colin Kaepernick is Muhammad Ali. Hell no. Muhammad Ali did interviews.
Right.
You know, he was accessible. What does this guy do?
Yeah.
You know, I don't know what he does. He wears a dashiki, you know, and he's got big hair. I mean, I know he does some good work, but my point is, you know, Nike is a capitalist company. It's a global brand. they're selling shoes with a social message
right.
to people that think it's cool to have a social message, but really they're just buying shoes. I mean, it's right. just the whole thing is stupid.
Right.
You know, it's
right.
you know, it's a ridiculous argument to have, and then you know people will be like, no, you need to take a stand. It's like, take a stand on what? It's
right.
Jello.
Yeah.
I'm not going to stand on it. It's quicksand. None of it means anything.
Yeah.
You know, everybody's got a weird interest in it, and the truth is, the problem is that the NFL and their players' union can't figure it out. It's the NFL's problem to figure out. It's not right. ours. Everybody feels like they have a say in the NBA. You know, LeBron does all kinds of social activism, stands for the anthem.
Right.
You know, they haven't figured out. You know, I mean, whether you should, I don't even think we should have the anthem.
I don't either.
You know, why? Why don't we have the anthem before the Taylor Swift show? What the hell? What
right.
are we doing?
Sense.
You know, it doesn't make sense but because of the advertiser. But if we're going to have the anthem, then, you know, they should figure out something with the players' union so you don't alienate half of your viewership. Because the
right.
truth is,
right.
it pisses those people off.
Yeah.
I go to Oklahoma. I go to mm-hmm. Texas. I do games all over the country. I love all kinds of different people, and they don't freaking like it.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think that translates to, you know, somebody, you know, in the CNN building or in a building, you know, where they're talking down to people. I think people kind of, there's a backlash against
yeah,
that.
Yeah, you can't talk down to them.
Yeah, I really think do that think really, that there is.
It's like the aftermath of the McCain thing that when he passed away, the thing was that he could be in disagreement with someone and still respect that person, still be able to see their point of view.
We have a race to the bottom now.
Yes.
And it's funny, you know, it's crossing over in sports. You see, you know, that idiot Mark Jones and the stuff with the Pac-12,
yeah.
you know, all this, you know, poor Kirk Herbstreit had to leave Columbus, you know?
Yeah.
I mean,
mm-hmm.
people are not rational.
Crazy.
You know, it doesn't bother, I'm not that popular, but after the games, I look my name up on Twitter and I read all the tweets about what a terrible broadcaster I am, and everybody has a laugh, and then
right.
you put it away. But some people take it real seriously.
I knew someone who used to get a lot of that, and they wouldn't read it. It said it messed with his head.
They
couldn't look at it.
I would think so.
Should we do it? All right. Hey, we cannot thank you enough.
I'll come back.
Please. This was wonderful.
Am I going to get in trouble? Am I going to get Braylon Edwards? Did I do anything bad?
No.
No. I'm still seeing a pulling guard cat.
Yeah.
The cat. Yeah,
the cat.
They're coming around.
Tea.
That's beautiful. Hey, this was great. Yeah. Thank you very much. Check us out on our podcast, The Drill Morning Briefing.
This is a great show. You guys are
a great show. His show's
he's a lovely
good.
Human being. Thanks again.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.